My name is Anna Dolner, and today I will be presenting a basic overview of malaria. The objectives of this presentation are to familiarize you with the epidemiology, transmission cycle, and clinical manifestations of malaria. We will also discuss how to diagnose malaria as well as how to treat and prevent it. We will discuss malaria. According to WHO estimates, there were 216 million cases of malaria worldwide in 2010. Over 90% of cases were due to infection with Plasmodium falciparum. The vast majority of cases occurred in Africa. Overall, the number of cases of malaria worldwide has decreased about 20% since 2000. Malaria is also a major cause of death worldwide, leading to an estimated 655,000 deaths in 2010. Again, the vast majority of these were in Africa. Sadly, almost 90% of these deaths occurred in children under the age of 5. On a more positive note, the number of deaths from malaria have also decreased significantly since the year 2000. This map shows the geographic regions in which malaria is endemic. These regions include most of Central and South America, Africa, the Middle East, and Southeast Asia. Malaria is transmitted through the bite of a female Anopheles mosquito that is carrying the malaria parasite. There are multiple species of Plasmodium parasites that cause malaria. The most common are Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium malariae, Plasmodium ovale, and Plasmodium vivax. The parasite is transmitted to uninfected mosquitoes when they bite an infected human during periods of parasitemia. Thus, humans act as the reservoir for this parasite. This slide shows the complicated life cycle of the Plasmodium parasite. We will not discuss this in detail. The take-home points from this slide are, number one, that humans act as the reservoir that allow the spread of the Plasmodium parasite from infected to uninfected mosquitoes. And number two, that humans become symptomatic about 12 to 35 days after they are bitten when schizonts are released and the parasite enters the bloodstream to begin the erythritic cycle, which is labeled as B on the slide. This slide discusses the clinical manifestations of uncomplicated malaria. The symptoms of malaria are variable and include fever, chills, headache, cough, nausea and vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain, myalgias, and arthralgias. Because malaria is so prevalent, it should be considered in anyone with a fever who has recently been in an area in which malaria is endemic. Note that the fevers are initially irregular and paroxysmal, but later in the course of infection become synchronous with schizont release. Fevers occur every 48 hours with Plasmodium ovale, falciparum, and vivax infection. They occur every 72 hours with Plasmodium malariae infection. On exam, patients may be tachycardic tachypneic. They may be jaundiced and have splenomegaly. Abnormal laboratory findings may include anemia, thrombocytopenia, transaminitis, mild acute kidney injury with elevated BUN and creatinine, and mild parasitemia. Again, malaria is considered to be complicated if the patient is obtunded. This is most common with Plasmodium falciparum infection. Symptoms of complicated malaria are also variable and can include seizures, lung injury, specifically acute lung injury or acute respiratory distress syndrome, circulatory collapse, metabolic acidosis, renal failure with hemoglobinuria, which is called black water fever due to the dark urine that is produced, liver failure, coagulopathy, intravascular hemolysis, and hypoglycemia. It can affect all organ systems and lead to multi-organ failure. On exam, altered mental status, pallor, and petechiae can be present. Laboratory examination can reveal anemia, thrombocytopenia, transaminitis, coagulopathy, acute kidney injury, hypoglycemia, and hyperparasitemia. This is defined as greater than 5% parasitized red blood cells in low transmission areas, and greater than 10% parasitized red blood cells in high transmission areas. There are several ways to diagnose malaria. The traditional method and current gold standard is to use light microscopy to examine slides prepared from patients' blood samples. Two different preparations, which are called thick and thin smears, are prepared and stained with GIMSA. Thick smears destroy red blood cells but not the parasites. They allow sampling of larger quantities of blood and are therefore good for identifying low-level parasitemia. Thin smears allow visualization of parasites within red blood cells and allow identification of species, stage, and degree of parasite burden. These slides are prepared from blood samples taken from patients every 6 to 12 hours for a 48-hour period. Thus, this method is quite time-consuming and also requires microscopy training. Because of these drawbacks, rapid diagnostic tests have been developed and are currently the standard of care in malaria-endemic countries. Blood samples are placed on membranes impregnated with antibodies to various Plasmodium epitopes. The assay can be performed rapidly and interpreted by individuals with minimal training. We will discuss the treatments recommended by the WHO for uncomplicated malaria. The treatment of complicated malaria is beyond the scope of this talk. The recommended treatments vary by region and by Plasmodium species. For Plasmodium falciparum, artemisinin-based treatment regimen is recommended as first-line therapy. Multiple approved regimens are listed below. For non-falciparum malaria, a combination of chloroquine and primaquine is recommended as first-line therapy. If local resistance rates are high, an artemisinin-based regimen can be used. The medications recommended for malaria prophylaxis in travelers vary depending on the region of travel and local resistance patterns. Chloroquine is recommended as first-line therapy unless resistance rates are high. If they are, mefloquine, doxycycline, or etobicoke proguanil can be used. If there are high rates of resistance to both chloroquine and mefloquine, doxycycline is preferred. There are multiple strategies used to limit the spread of malaria among residents of endemic regions. First, antimalarial drugs should be used to treat infected individuals and should be provided for intermittent treatment for pregnant women. Vector control is another important strategy and includes spraying insecticides inside homes, the use of insecticide-treated nets, environmental management, and efforts to sterilize the local mosquito population by introducing sterilizing mutations. Personal protection strategies include the use of bed nets and mosquito repellent. An important long-term strategy is vaccine development, and there are many efforts underway to develop an effective vaccine. To summarize, malaria is an enormous worldwide burden and leads to over 500,000 deaths per year. Transmission occurs through the bite of an Anopheles mosquito carrying the parasite. Clinical manifestations are variable, but malaria should be suspected in any individual who has a fever who is recently in a malaria endemic region. Artemisinin-based therapies are generally preferred for treatment, especially for Plasmodium falciparum. Multiple options are available for prophylaxis in travelers and should be targeted to local resistance patterns in the area of travel. Finally, local control efforts and vaccine development are key to future progress in decreasing the burden of this disease. Thank you.